My first video I named Saluda Mountain. And I've talked to people all the time about Saluda Mountain. Does anybody here, you all are experts, you live here, you know all this, where is Saluda Mountain? It's on here. As far as I can tell, it doesn't exist, and the name just evolved, perhaps from the railroad, because the railroad had used it in the late 1800s, and so much about the history of this town is connected with the railroad, and so much of that evolved in that way. One of the questions a lot of people ask me is how fast the trains go and why do they go different speeds? And so when we go downgrade, we're talking about trains that are going eastbound, going that way. And this is obviously when they were still running, but the last 10 years or so they ran trains. Light engines means just the locomotives when they were running by themselves. Passenger trains, we had a number of excursions in the 90s. They both ran at 15 miles an hour. Freight trains ran at 8 miles per hour. And you go back in years, a lot of freight trains ran at 6 miles per hour. And part of what's important is that there's a timing zone on the other side of the mountain. If you know where what they call sand cut is, 500 feet past there, this timing zone starts. And there were different monitors, human monitors, mechanical monitors, and they kept their eye on the train. When it got to the end of the timing zone, if he was within a time frame, it meant he was doing the proper speed. If not, the switch at the bottom of the hill would stay aligned with the runaway track, and he would go up the runaway track. And the time that I covered things down there, that didn't happen very often. And the one time it happened was kind of on a bet, but they learned a lot of things about it because three of the engines got locked in here. They could not back the train up. So three engines are parked in here, and there's one engine that's free, is not on the switch yet. So they disconnected the three engines, pulled them forward. Then they went back and cut, I think, 4 or 5 cars so they'd have room to get the engines out. They went up the whole hill and tied down the brakes on every one of the cars, except these first 3 or 4. And then they pulled forward here. And then there was room for the engines to back out. And they threw the switch. They brought the engines out, put them in front. And had there not been a railfan photographer there, maybe the public never would have learned about it. It's one of those things where the people involved were smart enough to handle their error, and everything got treated well, and there wasn't any problem. Back to the speeds. Everything going uphill could go up to 25 miles an hour. And back then, I can't remember the police chief's name, but I got to know him, and I said, and he had this radar gun, and he was always trafficking people down here. And I said, when this train comes up, I want to know how fast it's going. So the first one was like 28. And if you remember, or if you know about it, we're going to talk about the triple in a minute. They come up 3 times in sequence. And the second time they came up like at 32. And I said, And so I talked to a fellow who knows everything. And he said, well, the speed limit's 25. He says, but nobody gets a ticket for going too fast going up the hill. Going down the hill, you'll hear from your boss, but going up the hill. And that's a technical reason. When I first got here, I could not understand, especially these tracks here, why they were divided like they were. I knew a lot about railroading, but it didn't make sense to me. I interviewed these two women who were in their 90s in Saluda, South Carolina, and they were at an older folks' home, and their father was a pusher engineer, and he had real strict rules that they could not ride on his engine. Now, there were 2 or 3 pushers back in those days, and they rode on somebody's. They loved it, and they'd come home covered with coal, because that's where they'd sit, back in the coal pile. But we don't have pusher engines, probably once the diesels took over. And when the diesels take over, they've got plenty of power, but you may have heard there used to be a lot of problems with broken couplers on the grade here. And that's because there was just too much force. The engines are pulling, and as the cars come off a level spot and start going up the hill, the force increases on the coupler. So they figured it out that they could carry X amount of cargo. You may remember the big long chip cars that came up here, and there would typically be 13 in a run together. 13, that weight, I forget the weight, but I just know 13 cars of that was all they could run to be within limits. If they went, say, 10 miles per hour below their speed they were trying to maintain, they were to bring the train to a stop. Because the slower you go, and I do not understand the physics, but I've had some engineers explain it to me, the slower you go, the greater becomes the stress on the couplers. Likewise, the faster you go, the less stress there is on the couplers, such that these guys who were supposed to go 25 could go 30, and nobody was going to give them any trouble because there was far less likely that the coupler would break at the higher speed. They didn't want to spend money on pusher locomotives, and they decided to go over the hill with cuts of trains that only weighed so much. And this is the first cut right here, and he is right here. He has just left Melrose, and you can see he's right on the bridge. The second part of the bridge is with the white panel is the Pacolet River, and this side is the little Pearson's Falls Road. And so there, he's starting up the hill. You can see that the hill gets pretty steep pretty quickly. This was the steepest grade in the country for eons until they shut the grade down. It's still there, it's still the steepest if they got back in business, which they aren't. But the average grade on here is in the range of 4.5%. That's really steep. The next closest active grade is in New Mexico, and that's 3.3%. Other than that, everything max grades are in the twos and high ones. It's just inefficient to really run that kind of grade over and over again. So that train then goes up the hill, comes over here. He comes in this crossover right here and parks those cars right there. Then he goes back and he goes down the hill. On one of the videos we were watching here earlier, we showed that as they go past Thompson's store, one of the brakemen who had jumped off the train coming in, went and got hamburgers and stuff, he gets back in the engine and he rides down with the engine and they all have lunch. It's one of those things that's officially a no-no, but was okay. So now these two engines have just left Thompson's and they're heading down the hill, that side over there, and they're going to get the second cut of cars. They'll pick them up, they'll take them back up, they'll come down here, and then they'll back in here and park them here or park them here. With the trains that were all chips, it didn't matter where they parked. But if you had certain cars on, they had to be at the front or the back or ready to be switched, and so there were positions. That picture is recreated almost exactly. The engine goes down, picks up the rest of the cars, comes up here, and if he parked a set here, then he goes up here, backs his set in here, then he backs everything up, and now he's remade his train, and he's ready to go to Asheville. And so he does all the air checks, brake checks, and everything else. Then they get clearance from Norfolk Southern, and they take off and go. I've seen, and it's not unusual, that the trains will arrive at Melrose with half a dozen extra cars. So in that case, they have a foursome instead of a triple. I saw them one time, a quintuple. They made five runs over there. A train came up from Spartanburg, and he had a whole coal train, which was probably 110 or 120 cars, and they're all empty. So there's no problem with him, but weight-wise, but he just has a lot of them. And then he had a regular train, and we were up here. We just got real tired of watching it. But they did it five times. You know from this grade and its history This is one of the most dangerous railroad grades in the country, and it had likely the worst accident record just because it was so steep. Lots and lots of crashes. I had the good fortune to interview engineers who were on the two final crashes. One of them, a fellow, was just funny as can be, talking about jumping off, and he was on this one. And they jump off at Sand Cut, because Sand Cut is the only place on the hill that's not steep and rocky and doesn't have lots of thorns. It's gone. The railroad took it out for the sand. But the sand there, that's what they would jump in. And so then they walk down the hill. It's another mile and a half for them to come down the hill. And one of the men broke his ankle. So two guys carried him down between their arms. And that's really, it's tough carrying on the sidewalk, much less on a railroad track. Took him down. He got down there, and there were six of these locomotives. And they were up farther in the hill and off to the side. And five of them were still running. He said, I remember I had to climb over these engines and climb through everything and shut off all the engines. The other engineer said he had brought his train up from Asheville, and he got into Saluda here, and he's setting the brakes. And the road foreman came up, and he told the road foreman, it's not working right. It just doesn't feel right. So the road foreman said, call the technical department and see what they say. So he talks to him, and they called back, and they told him, you can take the train down the hill. And like he told me in the interview, he was right. He says, we took it halfway and jumped off here. The train ran away from him, and that was the last crash on Saluda Grade. So since 1971, there has never been a reported incident on Saluda Grade. Now, obviously, it's been closed for 15, 16 years now, but it was 30 years of accident-free railroading. So that Saluda Grade, instead of being at the bottom of the list, it retired over the past 30 years at the very top of the list. Not one problem at all. But there was one. And I'm going to tell you about it. The reason that picture's up there, just imagine that weather, a little bit more snow, sleeting, cold wind. It's just nasty weather. The train is going away from us, and it wasn't a steam engine. And they stopped right there, like they always did, and worked the brakes. They're going to go back and set the retainers. And the retainers, I'll try and make it simple because it gets to be real complicated. Retainers, you know, you've heard about a trucker going down the hill and he used the brakes too much and now he has no more brakes. Well, railroading is, you can do the same thing. So they put a retainer and it retains a certain amount of air pressure in the line. And so they set that. They have to go through every car out here. You see those brakemen conductors walk in every car, and they set the retainers so it has enough brakes to always stop the train. And they get a bite to eat, you know. And so then they're ready to go. Melvin Warren, the guy I'm talking about before, he was the engineer. And they start going down the hill. And right away, his brakes aren't working. He's not getting the response he needs. They didn't go very far down the hill before they declared that they'd lost control of the engine. And they jumped off. Not down here. They're up in this area right here. And they jumped off the train. Now, here's a bunch of professional railroaders. And they're in the snow, and their trains leave them. They don't like that. That's really crushing. And they went over what they did. They talked about it. The train is not going real fast. It's got brakes on it, but it's not stopping. And then they get to the end of the train. The last half dozen cars were empty chip cars. And what Melvin noticed was that the chip cars weren't running into the cars in front of them going downhill. Their brakes were working. And they got to thinking, is this train going to stop itself? And it did. On the grade. It is hard for an engineer who knows what he's doing to stop the train on the grade. And it stopped in the snow on the grade. All they can figure, the wind was blowing, it blew in between the brakes and on the wheels. The wheels were warm when it got here, so the snow got on it and melted. And they were here long enough, and it was cold enough with the wind that the wheels got cold enough to freeze all the water and all the precip that was on them. And so between the brake shoe and the wheels was ice. And it wouldn't stop. Anyway, so then they walked to the train. Now they're at the tail end of the train, and they're going along, and the brakemen, everybody, as fast as they can, they're tying down all the brakes. No, 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 it stopped. It finally stopped itself. Yes, yeah. So now the brakes were already on because it stopped the train, but they manually tied it down, so there's just absolutely no mistake. They called Asheville and told them what happened. And so they said, we'll send two locomotives out. Took an hour and a half for two locomotives to get here. Can you imagine how cold these guys are? It's just bitter cold. They're not feeling good. They're bugged at themselves, and you know. So they hooked the engines onto the back of the train and acted as a brake, and they took it down the hill. From there they proceeded, and everything went just fine. Now, Melvin Warren told me this story right here, right outside this, on the deck of this building. He says, you can't tell anybody. I said, all right, I won't. Now, Melvin didn't know me that well, except I'd been consistently around here with my camera. So I didn't tell anybody. Norfolk Southern does a magazine every month for its employees. And a woman calls me and she says, we're doing a story on Saluda Grade. And I've been checking around, and I talked to some people, and they said, I should talk to you. Great. So we talked a good bit, and we finished. And I said, you know, you ought to talk to number one, Melvin Warren. He's terrific. So she did. Or wait a minute. I don't know what she did. I got off the phone. And a little while later, in fact, I think it was the next day, she calls me. And she says, I really want to thank you, da, 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 da. I talked to Melvin and had a long conversation with him. And I said, oh, what'd you all talk about? Da, 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 da. And about the train that ran away in the ice. And I thought, wait a minute. I talked to her and I said, Melvin is a nice guy. And he just doesn't get that you're the press. He doesn't get that you're gonna print the best story. And so I said, you may just feel better about yourself if you call him and see what he wants. She calls me a little while later and she says, oh, thank you. He didn't want it to get out. So in the magazine over here, they printed the story. You can just kind of hold it up in here. And back here at the end of it, this is a company publication. And it just really blew me away. I'm looking at the story. I said, oh, it's real good. There's a little box back there this big. And it said, if you'd like to buy videos from Bob Loehne, you can. And I've never seen them do that. And I talked to her, and I said, thank you. And she says, you were so nice to me and saved us that we just wanted to do something for you. So that's how that went. In any case, that's why I showed you that picture. That's the kind of weather that it was. There's a friend of mine who's named Jerry Sullivan. He used to work for the Southern for a long time. He's a guy who rides in the car that tests how the car is riding and tests the track, and he knows all about the ground. He's a geologist and all sorts of stuff like that. So I've asked him a lot of questions about, I did stories up here about on the Clinchfield Railroad, and they have exactly the same kind of mountains as we do here. You know, all this slag, it's in the mountains, and the mountains shift around, And up there, they had terrible problems with it. And I told him that I measured some stretches on the Saluda grade to see if I agreed with, remember that blue chart that was up here in the beginning? That had a lot of dimensions and said what the grade was. And I told him, I found some that were a whole percent off. And I found some that where the track really wasn't that smooth. It had a little wave to it. And he said, well, he knew I was familiar with the Clinchfield. And he said, well, it's the same kind of territory. The ground at time gets wet and it slips and slides and they have landslides and whatnot. So he told me that he had been in Colombia and he was working with some sort of real heavy equipment. And they decided to put it on the back of the pasture train that was coming up here and going to somewhere at Ludlow, Kentucky. And he said, we didn't think anything of it because we did this sort of stuff all the time, putting freight, in this case, a real heavy car, on the back of the pasture train. And they got up here to Saluda, and they came up the grade, and it was draining and drizzling, and it was in the fall. And when you get leaves on there and wet, the track just gets slick as can be. And the train stalled. This kind of engine right here stalled right down there on the hill. He said, before he knew it, this brakeman came up front and he had two scoops. And they kept scooping up sand and leading the engine. And they said for about a mile, he walked about a mile, keep getting back more sand. And the engine went going. And as they got near the top, not because the grade got shallower, but because he thought it was because the sun was coming out and in that time it had taken him. But in any case, he made it up the hill by doing that, just continually pouring sand on there. Right here in downtown Saluda, the same guy told me another story. When you look ahead, which is right down here, if you walk down the tracks, trees are different and everything else, but you walk down there, you'll see this view. And you see how the tracks bend over. A vertical curve is when the track curves down or curves up. And those curves are more dangerous to the railroad than are the horizontal curves. In any case, they started running a train called the Belmont train, which went down to Belmont Power Plant down there and dropped off loads of coal. It was a test for Southern, or at some point it became a test, because they would leave with a brand new train from Andover, Virginia, come through Natural Tunnel. It had one of the finest railroad routes because of all the scenic things it passed on its way. Got to Saluda, went down Saluda, went to the power plant, unloaded the cars, turned around, went back, got reloaded every 40 hours. And that was their goal, to do that all the time. The train was what they called a radio train. It had engines running in the center of the train, not pushers. They're part of the main consist of engines, and they're running and they're controlled by the head engineer. There's no engineer in the middle group. And they're able to run track speed wherever they went, except here on their steep grade. Of course, they were running track speed there too. But anyway, they had a problem right here in downtown. They were getting broken couplers on both sides from this train, and they couldn't figure it out. So he and his boss got together and said, well, gosh, the only piece of track that's kind of different is right here at the crossing. So they watched right that one spot, and he said right before their eyes, he saw a coupler break. He said he didn't know anyone else who ever saw one. It was right there waiting for it to break, and it did right before him. And they realized that it was kind of covered up because of the road crossing, but it came to a little point instead of a smooth curve. And they took care of it right away. On another video, I happened to be on a train that broke a coupler, and the guys just laughed, and he says, this rarely happens here anymore, and you got to be on my train with a video camera. But he didn't mind, took it back there, and two guys can do it real quickly. One guy, it's a lot more strain and whatnot. There's a big bolt, you lift the bolt out, bring the coupler out. The harder thing is the drawbar. If the drawbar pulls, you're dead. You can't do anything. The drawbar is what the coupler is connected to. And if you pull that out, you gotta wait till heavy maintenance comes out. The first railroad video I ever did was about Spencer Shops. And it was the transition of Spencer from our freight railroad into the North Carolina Transportation Museum. This is a book by Matt Bumgardner. If you want to know a lot of great history, well-written history, it's interesting writing, a lot of details. I know Matt real well, and I'm really pleased with the work he did on this book. They sell the book here, they sell my DVDs. They make millions of dollars here every week selling this stuff.